inventor, the creator of the Casa di Fiducia, that is the publisher of that. And I think that all the people in this country who know something about Italian culture know very well the very important role played by the Adelphi publishers in the, well, really, in the shaping of Italian culture for the past 20 years. I am absolutely certain that the whole intellectual and cultural Italian landscape would have been completely different if Roberto Calasso had not been there with his character, with his invention, with the beautiful craftsmanship with which every book is edited, translated, and offered to the readers. And we are extremely grateful for all that. Just a few words to introduce our guest. I do not think it's important to introduce it, but my very friend, Maria Warner, is a wonderful novelist. She's a historian, she's a critic, and she's a person who is gifted by a very particular intellectual charm, which makes her a very special person and writer. Her latest book, which is called No Ghost to Go to Men Scaring Love, was published a few months ago by Marco. What shall we say about Sandro Rutti? Absolutely nothing. The only thing I can say is that Salman has just finished his new novel. The title is The Ground Beneath the Feet. It will come out in April, simultaneously in English and in the Italian version published by also. I will leave the floor to you. I shall sit here just to help you, if you don't mind the words. And again, too much for me. Maria, would you like to start?
Right. these polytheistic demons and their wild excesses, their fantastic orgies and massacres. Multiplicity of heads and limbs for the bodies of the gods and goddesses are matched by multiplicity of plot lines and subplots and incidents. As Carasso tells us, the Mahabharata, one of his chief sources, is the longest epic poem in the world, far, far longer than Homer, and in scale, a Bible, compared to the single sonnet, if you like, of the epic of Gilgamesh. He writes in Carr, "In the beginning, stories were no more than appendices to knowledge, but gradually the time given over to them grew, and the gaps in that knowledge, like grass between the bricks of the altar of fire, expanded and multiplied in stories that generated more stories, until they covered the whole construction of knowledge in which they had made their first furtive appearance as no more than intermezzo." Carr sets aside all Judeo-Christian revulsion against such pagan monsters, hybrid forms, grotesque pluralities of bodies and stories, against metamorphoses. He revisions the legends as a classical compendium, meditative, enigmatic, and controlled. His earlier book, The Marriage of Kallos and Harmony, purposefully imitated Greek mythology. It offered a kind of alternative reading of Hesiod's Theogony and Ovid's Metamorphoses, using lesser-known sources like Nonnus. For, as Levi Strauss pointed out famously, there is no original version of a myth. Every retelling is a myth in itself, every variation another story, to set alongside the one that may precede it chronologically, but doesn't therefore take precedence as truth or as fiction. Carasso is a mythographer for today. He is passing on the myths of the mind and gods of India, as his subtitle to Carr promises. But he is also making a new text, shaped to his own taste, his own emotional centers of pleasure, his own learning, which is vast, and his perception of his reader's desires. And this he can tell us himself later. Carr is a very oblique book, and so I want to end by an oblique reference or two to one or two other stories that illuminate, I think, Carasso's concept of how myths are written on one hand, and historical ideas about writers of myths themselves. In 1921, J.G. Fraser, author of The Golden Bough, translated and edited The Library by Apollodorus, and as it's known, and as it's still called, in the Loeb edition, which is our scholarly edition. I don't know what the Italian scholarly edition is, because that's what
we
This book, composed in the first century BC, one of the many deep reservoirs of classical stories into which later poets, dramatists, all manners of writers have drawn. But it isn't by the learned Apollodorus, a much earlier historical character who was a stickler for truth and something of a rationalist. The flamboyant anthology late borrowed his name later to dignify itself in a maneuver that was very common in the ancient and medieval world. Authors were as much fiction. Much later, the strange figure of Nonnus of Panopolis put on another pyrotechnical display in his Dionysicon in honor of the god of wine. But he was so all-embracing his interests and allegiances that he also composed a paraphrase of St. John's Gospel in Greek. The borders between creeds in the Hellenistic world were not closed, and in many ways our times, at their best, can reflect heterogeneousness, Catholicity, the effervescence and dynamism of those changing, porous times when the Greek and Roman hegemonies were failing. And I think, in a way, both Carasso and Salman Rushdie typify that disintegration in its best form of the boundaries between creeds and languages. Shakespeare drew his own portrait of such a mythographer in The Tempest. In Prospero, his magic arts arise from his books. The magician writer as scholar, as alchemist, as wonder worker, and plotter of stories. Carasso performs rather Prospero-like, his kind of conjuring. His so potent art is very bookish, and it reinvents him, the author, as a presiding Mr. God, as much as it stages the subjects of the stories he tells. Carr does not show, he tells. It deepens the mystery rather than dispels it. It doesn't decipher the myths in the manner of the work of the Sanskrit scholar Mindy Denigan, for example, in her book Women, Androgynes and Other Beasts, or comment on the making of the stories as Robert Irwin does in his book on the Arabian Nights. In Calasso is retrieving the myths for literature, not for the academy. He's clearly fascinated with the myth's exploration of language, how Bach, voice, exists at the beginning as a generative force in itself. How meters, poetic meters, are also formative and performative. They bring phenomena, deities, into being. As he points out, no other trace of these civilizations exists besides these stories. Only these words remain. So in India, it's not only at the beginning, but also at the end, that there's only the word made flesh.
Phantoms of the Greek stories, the Roman stories, do live amongst us. So that's really not true of the Hindu stories in Western culture anyway. So that's a bigger mountain to climb. Another problem is that these, unlike the Greek stories, these stories are not dead. These gods have not died. As I said, there would be a lot of people who would know these stories, and for them it would simply be the Hindu religion, or it would be legislated for the Buddhist religion. These gods have not, you know, retreated to Olympus and just become tales we tell. They're very active in the lives of very large numbers of people. And the third problem which derives from that is that these are in many ways quite politically fraught stories still. So that when Roberto tells the story of Ram and Sita, it's not only an exploration of Sanskritic texts, it also certainly makes me aware of the way in which those stories are being used today in India as part of the fabric of Hindu nationalism. In ways that are quite problematic. Similarly, when the delightful story of the day spent by the youth of the god Krishna, spent in by the forests of Vrindavan near the town of Mathura, and you know, disporting himself with the gopis, the beautiful gopis, and meeting his love, Radha, and so on. I mean, of course, it's a beautiful story, it's beautifully told, but also, I can't help remembering that after the destruction of the Babri Masjid in Ayodhya in North India, which was destroyed because it was believed to have been built on the birthplace of Lord Ram, the next site was the alleged birthplace of the Lord Krishna, in exactly the locations where these wonderful disportments are taking place. So there is the difference in this book that we're dealing with living material and not with dead myths. Given all that, I think that it's Collazo's achievement in this book to transcend all that immediate material and to allow us, whether or not we know about these stories, to enter the world of these stories and to enter the world of stories in a way as the believers might. As I say, not in a totally secularized way, but with the kind of belief that we have about fictional characters, these characters become credible to us as we read the book in the same way as a brilliantly drawn fictional character that have that kind of authority. And I think it's a very considerable achievement for material like this, which is not what might say the event. One of the things I think that is shared between the Hindu pantheon and the Greek and Roman pantheons is that these gods are not offered to us as role models. It's a very interesting and attractive feature of polytheism. That the gods behave very badly, and could in no sense be held to be moral arbiters, because they do all kinds of things that we would believe to be very reprehensible, turn themselves into bulls and gallop off with damsels, whatever it might be. And they ask from us not that we do as they do, not that we see them as definitions of good and evil, but only that we worship them. That's it. and since, in fact, they behave rather like us, it's a great deal easier to worship them than those other sterner deities who do play that higher role. So I think the kind of low behavior of the gods is a very attractive feature of theirs, and particularly in this book, where, believe me, there's plenty of low behavior. I just which is the study of Indo-European culture. And the attempts that there have been in the course of the last more than 100 years to see what these great stories might have in common, and indeed whether they sprang from common stock, whether in fact there are Ur stories, you know, from which as the Aryan migrations went in their different directions, there were varying versions formed in India, where one strand of migration went in Ur and went from there. And I suppose that the sort of father of these studies I think they're still very highly respected in India, is the figure of Max Müller, who still has houses dedicated to, would you bear his name, dedicated to studying these things in New Delhi and elsewhere. Müller's, one of his central ideas was that all the myths, all the bodies of myths that existed as a result of the Aryan migrations, were in essence stories about the sun. That they were in some sense all sun myths. And indeed some of his disciples carried this to an extreme which actually got Müller's ideas somewhat ridiculed, argued that Jesus Christ, the story of Jesus Christ and the disciples, was actually apocryphal and was only a representation of the sun and the 12 points of the zodiac. When this idea was put forward, critics of Müller school of thought began to ridicule it, and there were comical essays published proving that Napoleon and his generals were also in fact points of the zodiac. And in one case, an essay which proved that Max Müller himself could not possibly have existed, and nor could Oxford University. Unfortunately, Müller's ideas did fall into this kind of disrepute because of being pushed too far. Now, whether or not he's right, that all these stories start off as sun myths, is questioned, and has been questioned by many people. One development of that was the equation of the Greek god Uranos, the sky god, and the Hindu god Varuna, who is one of the kind of proto-creator figures in the Hindu pantheon. You can hear the assonance of the names. And that has led many people to suggest that Uranos and Varuna are actually the same deity, having gone in different directions in different countries. When you start looking at the parallels that exist between the great myths of, let's say, the Iliad and the Odyssey on the one hand, and the Ramayana and the Mahabharata on the other hand, you also find extraordinary echoes. The Ramayana is about a prince whose wife is captured and taken away to a foreign country, and then a great war has to be fought to liberate her. We can hear a very similar structure in that to the structure of the Iliad. There are actually scenes in the two compendiums which are very close. So there's a famous scene in the Iliad where Helen is on the ramparts of Troy with the elders of Troy, identifying the heroes of Greece, saying, you know, that is Achilles, that's Odysseus, that's Ajax, etc. And also, an extraordinary feature of that scene, as Homer writes it, is the way in which the old great figures of Troy find her incredibly sexually attractive while she's doing this. So it's an erotic power of Troy, and indeed the treasury, you know, of identifying the people of her own side. You know. There is a very similar scene in the Ramayana in which Sita is on the ramparts of the fortress of Ravan in Lanka, looking at the armies of Ravan. Now, she doesn't think that the identification of the enemy isn't there, but the image of the scene is there. Similarly, it's been suggested that the wily monkey king god Hanuman of the Ramayana has all kinds of assonances with the equally wily steaming figure of Odysseus in the armies of the Greeks. There's a story told in this book about the Hindu god of love, Kama, which is a very interesting to me reversal of the um, of similar story in Western culture. Kama, as a Cupid figure, is asked by Sita, is asked by Parvati to help the god Shiva fall in love with him. And he fires an arrow, his arrow of love, you know, at Shiva, but Shiva sees it coming and basically fries, blasts him with thunderbolt and reduces him to ash. So the god of love is killed. And what has to happen is that his wife, Rampi, has to go to Shiva and beg for his life and return to the underworld. So that in a kind of what extraordinary reversal of the Orpheus story, it is Eurydice, if you like, it's the woman who seeks from the god of the underworld the return of the dead man, which also happens to be the god of love. So all these things are, I think, all these curious echoes of asymmetries do exist, and one of the things I think is true, which doesn't always point to these things, is that as we read these myths, we can actually hear half echoes, resonances, rhymes with stories that actually existed in Western culture. What happened to the Indo-European project in this century was sad, because the term Aryan, which was used by the scholars to refer simply to a language group, was of course then misused in the middle of the century in the most poisonous way. And what happened is that the entire field of Indo-European studies was poisoned for more than a generation by the use made of it by the Nazis. The swastika, well known as an Indian symbol, runs the other way around. And actually, the word swastika comes from the Sanskrit word swasti, which means good. Swastika is a thing of good, and was a symbol of the Republic, was a sign of the gods, etc. The reversal of the swastika is a technique of black magic. In fact, that was the reversal that the Nazis made of, based on these distortions of the European scholars. So it's, I must say, very interesting to me and even moving to see the rebirth in this very much more contemporary form of this profound area of study. And I think that the remarkable achievement of Kat is to be at the one and same time a work of genuine scholarship and also in a way a novel. As I said, in the way that I suppose some time ago the generation that was called itself the new journalists used the techniques of the novel and applied it to journalism. Here we see the techniques of the novel applied to high scholarship. And the result is a book that breaks all the rules, that blurs the boundaries between forms, and that becomes a genuinely new thing. And that's rare enough in the world of books to be worth celebrating.
She's big things, as you know, but not an ethnologist, Commander. But she has jousted in a fascinating book on a fairly important fact about that, which is the fact of being scared. And I think India is the perfect example, because India, whatever you do with it, whether you hate or love it, or you read the text, or just refuse whatever comes from there, is the sort of archetypal object of fear for the guest. In other words, when, you know, the prince, when he started having his visions, open visions and so on, what did he see? He saw the first images of Indian gods, many heads and so on, as the sort of first image of terror, which came to a very lucid mind as his was. And that is right, because India is something which should create this fear. I mean, you have to elaborate it, you have to do something with it, but it is the fear, the sort of fundamental fear that we all feel. There was one of the major Italian writers of this century, Manganelli, who was a great Italian writer too, wrote a marvelous book called Experiment with India, telling the story of his trip there, first trip there. And the first chapter is only on this fact, of the sort of terrible anxiety he felt immediately as he started to prepare this trip. So, consider that he was a very eager traveler, and always wanted to get to places. So India was the only place which created that. So why? I think because India, it's difficult to say that in a few words, but trying to be as sort of to put it in a few words. India has gone from the beginning very far, maybe as far as humans could in certain directions, especially in the directions of thought. If you read the very first texts of the Indian thought, I don't say the Brahmanas because they are practically not available to the West, but that's it, the Upanishad. You feel that something has been going on there, which was a sort of one of the most daring things you can do with the mind. And that is as daring today as it was 3,000 years ago. So that is again, and that is scary enough, because it doesn't leave you with a sort of common sense basis, which was our fortune in a way, and a disaster. So when I don't want to tell a story which would be too long, but I think if you go towards India, you have to follow that sort of incredibly daring trip of the mind, which happened there since the beginning, since the very first moments we have a notion of. And I remember now, there is a sentence that I particularly like, and that's Rushdie quote in a beautiful essay he wrote. It is a sentence by N.P. Hartley. It says, the past is a foreign country. Things happen differently there, are done in a different way there. That applies to, first of all, to whatever I have tried to write, which was not only to India, but to the Western part. Because after all, that sentence applies to our own life, to our own past, our own life of 2 days ago. So if we want to have sort of perception of what is going on, let's start from ourselves and from very close to us, and then you find that it should be. is one, always the same. So it happened to me to go to India at a certain moment. After, I always was so fascinated by India, and even in the first part of this sort of work in progress, there's a large part on Vedic India, the whole of Kashmir, which was written many years ago. But after the marriage of Carlos, I felt something which I found one day to be way similar to what happened to one of the greatest Indologists around. And that is Wendy Doniger, who wrote some of the best books you can read on Indian mythology. Well, at a certain moment, she had to give the journal lectures here in England. And she realized she was getting more and more attracted to Greek myths. Having written of Sita and of Saranyu, she felt that she had to study Helen, because after all they were meaning something in the same direction. Because both Sita, both Saranyu and Helen are first of all Eidola, Simulacra. So this mental image which is commanding our life and which can develop in different ways. So exactly the same years, she was doing this journal lecture, so going from east to west, and the book has not yet appeared, it will appear, but it will be full of these Greek stories, and I, knowing nothing what she was going the other way. Because I felt that after all, well, it is the Greek stories which are for us, final background and not the final background. We start too late. We start with the gods. India doesn't start with the gods. The gods themselves are also late appearance. That is one of the paradoxes that you don't find in any other country, any other civilization. First of all, there is a being which is not even what we are used to as a sort of monotheistic being, Prajapati, the progenitor, is not exactly it, is something different. It is a sort of amorphous, weak, desperate being who dies in a way, is disarticulated in the course of creating the gods themselves, and that we add the function to sort of the gods themselves. Should put together again. So that was a huge landscape behind the gods. So it's God that many stories happen before the gods are there. In fact, nobody, no civilization is so cavalier in a way in its treatment of gods. I mean, it's full of irony. Indra, Shiva, Krishna too. They are treated well with immense devotion, but at the same time, you feel that there is something behind, and it is not only to Prajapati, it is something which has no parallel in the West. That is that strange figure of the Rishi, the seer. You know that these seers, the Sapta Rishi, the seven first seers, were supposed to exist before Prajapati himself. They put themselves together in order to create him. So it is another background which is here. It is, you have a feeling of vertigo, which is, you cannot avoid that. But you find things that you don't find anywhere else. So that's why I went there. So it has to do it. And now I will stop here. And if you have. I don't know. I mean, there are many questions. I mean, in what Rushdie said, I took many questions. Let's maybe just one point, because it's always very delicate. Point of inheritance, sterilized. So let's make it clear, because it's something where so horrible confusions happen that one should start from zero. Arabic and Sanskrit means no. There are various other interpretations, but at least that was the word used by the people who came to India from the northern part of Asia huge cities, they only give the language. Someone said, well, the Greeks, when the Parthenon, the sculptures, the chorus, the Indians, they just made the language. Sanskrit means perfect. They made this perfect shape, which is this language that we still admire and see as a sort of great achievement of the mind. So these were the Aryas. Then, at a certain moment of the 19th century, after Bob published his famous first comparative grammar of the European languages, and that a sort of course of studies developed on comparative mythology and comparative study of comparative civilizations. Among marvelous things which were discovered and studied in those years, a certain amount of garbage started to develop. There's a marvelous book by Leon Poliakov called Unitarian, where he traces back all, I mean, the origins and the development of this garbage, which went you know where at the end, and which was created mainly, but not really great scholars, but people who had a sort of smattering of some of the themes of his books and started to create totally things we had no ground at all. Of course, what remains is the fact that Indo-European is a cluster of civilizations which must be studied together. And there were some great scholars in this century who have for 40, 50, 60 years studied exactly that. And sometimes they were attacked because they were confused with other people. And that was a disaster. It would be seen for one of the greatest. Well, I remember he once said in a marvelous interview, he said, well, I would have hated to live in very India. I prefer to go to sit in a cafe in an avenue somewhere in Paris. I would have hated to live there. As I admire the civilization, I have felt the need to study, to understand what it's all about. Because there's one point that of all these Indo-European civilizations, the Vedic one is the one and only one which is based on truths, on enigmas. So that is why a great scholar is particularly attracted by it, because it is a terrible challenge. You know, you take the Rig Veda. Well, it looks from the outside as a collection of hymns, but this Rig Veda Samhita, a collection of knowledge Veda in the forms of hymns. So you take a parallel in the West. What you find is parallel, you find, for instance, marvelous Homeric hymns. In fact, there are parallels, but the part which is totally different, totally unique, is the larger part. And that part is a sequence of rituals, of enigmas. Because for them, knowledge, the central world of the kingdom, was a terribly dangerous enterprise. The form of knowledge, the basic form of knowledge, was what was called the primordial. So a dialogue in which a ritual was offered by one Brahman to another, the other one had to understand what it was all about. The risk was death. Death is very, very often find this old text that they speak of the fact of the hand just exploding. That is only India. That is the highest risk connected with knowledge to know of. But even here there is a parallel. If you look at the origin of Greek dialectics, you find that in the beginning, only in traces, you have something similar connected with rituals and the danger of being exposed to the industry, but after all the end of the story is gone. So you see, so and now
now this is a ritual, this is a question. Questions from the audience. We can give questions and answers for 30 minutes, so you are all the questions for to ask your questions if you have any. And if not, we will carry on upstairs.
Who had the heroism of translating this work translating this word candidism, in his introduction, insults this word, saying, well, never humanity thought of something so absurd, so true, so totally devoid of interest. At the same time, he allowed us to understand something, to get in touch with it. So you see, it's a series of paradoxes, one into the other. And Max Müller was a hero of this story, because it made it all possible. And we have to realize that our very, very civilized world is not so terribly civilized in terms of knowledge, because huge things which were available years ago are no more available in that way. And that makes you a bit uneasy.
Just a question I wanted to suggest to Carlson is one of the things, it's a normalistic question, one of the things that struck me about the way in which this book is composed is that you begin with the figure of Prajapati, this non-being whose fragmentation brings into being everything. You have a line where you say, in the beginning, Prajapati didn't know who he was.
Yes.
Only when the gods issued from him, when they took on their qualities, their profiles, only then did the question present itself. So at the beginning, there is, if you like, this kind of this pregnant void that explodes into the universe, and that becomes everything, that becomes stories of gods and adventures, and becomes the life of the book itself. Now at the end of the book, or near the end of the book, when the figure of the Buddha arrives, it's as if what you're suggesting is an ending of that endless profusion, proliferation of stories into the more abstract mysticism of Buddhism. You're quite severe about the Buddha. I just thought, since people are not often severe about the mind, one should just read these few sentences and ask him to comment on them. You say, what would one day be called the modern was at least as far as its sharpest and most hidden point is concerned in the legacy of the world. Seeing things as so many aggregates and dismantling them. Then dismantling the elements a bit off from the aggregates, insofar as they too are aggregates, and so on in disease succession. An arid, ferocious scholasticism. A taste for repetition as agent provocateur of inanity. Vocation for monotony. Total lack of respect for any prohibition or any authority. Emptying of every substance from within. Only husks left intact. The quiet conviction that war, etc.
Well, I'm happy to
less than 5 minutes
for the and I'm very happy to have this account. Because first of all, John Manley wrote marvelously on the Nagatavar books of this book, which I was so happy to read because he understood so well the literary stuff of which this book is made, in a way that I'm afraid only writers can do. No, don't want to be in any case, or ample, but in any case. There was one point on which I totally disagreed and I was really stunned to read. He was saying something similar to you in a more ascendant way, in a way. So saying, well, this book is so much against the Buddha that it is a good thing that the Buddha is not a follower of people so violent as well. After that I wrote a few lines to them and said, well, how such an understanding can. So I'll try to say, expose things on my side. Why the Buddha is there? Because it is, I'd say, first of all, so every writer would say, because the form needed it. I needed someone at the 14th part, and so that is something, you know. So exactly. presented as one needs a sort of anchor drugs to appear in a novel at a certain point. So it is, the Path of the Buddha is not a treatise, it would be ridiculous, it's a treatise on the Buddha. But the point is that it is not an end in the sense that you get to the end of a line, because there is no line, but there is a circle. And to have full circle, you need the Buddha. Exactly because of the reasons the Buddha was saying at the beginning. You know, the word of Prajapati, and of the Upanishad, is based on the word purna, that is fullness. It is a word of a sort of fullness overpouring into the world. And then you go through the whole history of thinking and consciousness in India, and you get to some totally to opposite situation. Everything is empty. The two images together make the whole, because that is our brain. We need them both. We cannot, in fact, in the Runakash, at the beginning, there is a part which is concerned exactly with that. We have two poles. In terms of kids of today, it's the analogical pole and the digital pole. I mean, our brain works in that way. So the Buddha, in a way, is a sort of inversion of the whole story going from starting with the rishis. And how do you see that? I mean, the key point for the rishis was a word, bandhu, which means relations, bind, to bind. The English word is exactly the same. Relations, the meaning which comes from putting a thing in relation, A, in relation to B. This whole huge net of meanings covering the whole world. And then you get to the Buddha and you find that he affirms, too, that there is such a net. But it is empty. It is empty. The meaning is not there because he has applied those things which are for me not something insulting, but that I highly admire. If you start decomposing things, analyzing, and doing that kind of operations, described, there is a subtle irony, because, you know, after Buddha, there was the Buddhist scholasticism was ferocious. That it created texts of such monotony that it is, well, only in Western scholasticism, but around Thomas of Aquinas, you can find something similar. So that is why, but the teaching of the Buddha is an essential point. I mean, this fact of dismantling whatever image you have in front of you is essential to us. And the real key point is one word. You know that all inner thought goes around one word, which is Atman, which is a... And there are values. You know, we were talking about the Prajapati not having an identity. Identity is the self. First, so discovering it, the self of Prajapati is made by the gods recomposing his body in the altar of fire. That's a complicated story, but it is a story which concerns us all, I mean, in every moment. I thought, there's one story which comes to my mind all the time when I talk of these things. You know, I think in this room, in this audience, I imagine that lots of people like to swim. And to see life swimming, and what do they do when they go to swim? They do something which is universally called crawl, which is simply swimming for us. Well, crawl is not such a simple thing. Crawl, first of all, was not a Western. It was a Polynesian technique, which was invented 150 years ago, more or less, and came to the West at the beginning of the century. Before that time, people didn't swim in that way. They swam in a way which in Italian is called la marinara. That is a much less effective way. And they thought swimming was that. Well, brings you more quickly, very far, which doesn't happen with other techniques. So that's my answer when I hear that kind of usual bigot question, why you belonging to a certain culture spend all your time talking about another culture. No, that is, it is that.
My phone, I'm sorry. This is, I've run out of battery.